Hey guys, it's Victor. Give me a break, man. Give me a flick, man. I have been struggling for the past few weeks to make you guys a laundry video. And I actually shot two of them, both 40 minutes long each. Tremendous, what's the word? Opius? Not opius. opiums? No, what the fuck is that word? Is it opius? Yes. Opiates? No, I don't know. Anyway, two long goddamn videos. And I used a new mic and the mic was skipping. It was kept peaking. Long story short, fucked up. I've had technical problems. I've had a really bad week when it comes to technical problems. I'm in the middle of Sakai, by the way. And this is, for those of you who don't know, this is a laundry video. I'm just going to say, fuck it. I'm just going to shoot it. Riding my bicycle home. So to ride my bicycle home. Ooh. And a lot of skateboarders out tonight, by the way. I ran into a bunch of skateboarders. I'll probably put up that video. They're all over the place. Hey, peace. And okay, let's get to the technical problems. FCP. I've got this thing called Final Cut Pro. I use it all the time. It's completely I installed the new version, completely fucked up my computer. I couldn't do anything. I lost all my files. I had to, after 3 days of trying to do something, I ended up having to reinstall using something called Time Machine. And that wasn't a complete fix, but it's better than nothing. So I was able to salvage some of the old files, but still not everything. And that's another technical fuck up. And seriously, I know some of you don't like the bad words, but fuck it. The situation was a complete. All I could say was, all I felt was saying was fuck a million times. It was horrible. Why is this guy?
どうしてそこに置くの?なんかない。僕、日本人じゃないけど僕でもしてるよ。髪の毛かっこいい。ありがとう。でもそれはちょっとね、僕やるよ。もう腹が立つから、こういうこと見ると。これ最後だよ。今度は喧嘩だよ。今度は喧嘩。もう死んじゃいない。
お客さんがこれを外に捨てた。捨ててください。怠け者。Motherfuckers. So, now my iPhone. There we go. Okay, back to this shit. I interrupted my goddamn laundry vlog for this. So I don't know if you guys saw that. I don't know how much was that because I completely forgot I was filming to confront that kid. But I'm like, why did you just leave your bottle on the floor? What the fuck's wrong with you? Well, I didn't say what the fuck is wrong with. Pretty much I said what the fuck, right? I said, what's wrong with you that we just leave it on the floor like that, right? He's like, there's no place to throw it away. I'm like, yes, there is, man. I'm like, I know that. Even a dumb guy like me knows that shit, man. And I told him, but you got a lot of nice hair, because his hair was dyed red. I like that. That was completely... I'm not going to fucking pick a fight with a guy because he throws garbage on the ground. But jokingly I said, next time you and me, we're going to fight. Kenka ni nare, we're going to fight next time. Of course, that's not true, but... Anyway, where the fuck was I? You know, here's the bizarre thing about me. I'm a happy person. I really am. But goddamn it, I'm angry all the fucking time too. Does that make sense? You guys understand that? The world is a beautiful place. I am marveling. I marvel every day at how beautiful the world is and how great life is. And the little things, even that, like that, that for some reason is just beautiful. And of course the ladies, they're all beautiful. But, yeah, Jesus, just recently, this is a thing that's been going through my mind recently. And before anyone goes off into, oh, you're having a midlife crisis, it's not about that at all. It's not about that at all. It's, I've just been appreciating life recently. I'm looking at things and I'm thinking, wow, life is beautiful, and the views you see every day. And I'm not talking about the hot girls. I'll be honest. Who doesn't love a flat stomach and nice peach-sized boobs? I mean, come on, those are great. I would be lying if I didn't say I didn't notice that. But I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the sky. I'm talking about the skyline, and not at night, of course, but when I go visit my in-laws' house out in the country, which is quite once a week usually, or twice a month. You know, I always marvel at how just beautiful everything is. They make fun of me because I love rice fields, right? I love the rice fields. And I took a whole series of rice field pictures, which I don't even know what I'm going to do with, you know? Just beautiful pictures. But I've had this feeling recently. It's a pretty easy, pretty simple feeling. The feeling is we are visitors. We're just visiting here. And it's okay, you know? And I've had this thought about temporariness? I'm sure there's a better word for that, but since I'm riding a bicycle when holding a camera in one hand, it's the best you're gonna get right now, you know? And this is unedited. The temporariness, you know, life is temporary, and there's not much you can do about that. But that's part of the beauty, you know? And I've been thinking about this recently, and I see it. This feeling has been magnified in the things I see and do every day. There are other things, of course. I mean, I could go on and on. I mean, the two laundry vlogs I talked about before, I talked a lot about my son and how he's learning words, and all that's amazing, and it's a lot of fun, and I really enjoy it. Dave, just a minute. I just ran into an old friend. Hey, man. How you doing? You still working at this place?
Of course.
Yeah? Good to see you. I got the camera on right now, if you don't mind.
Okay.
Yeah, how you doing? How's the kid? You got one, too?
Just one, yeah. He's fine. He's nearly nine now.
Nine? Oh, my God. It's been that long.
It'll be nine in January, yeah.
So that means that's been... When did you have him? How long after Fisher Cabaret Club and all broke up?
Well, I guess I was just before I was 40, yeah. So, I mean, I'm 48 now, so...
Wow, I'm 49 now, so...
Right.
You look great, though. You don't look like me. You look a lot younger than I do.
Well, you're looking fine.
Now we're just stroking each other off now. Right?
Yeah.
How you doing? Everything good?
Yeah. You know, keeping busy. I'm still writing music.
I'm good.
Doing a play with Brian Cullen at the moment.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. So. Yeah, I got my own thing going on YouTube and my school, and I'm pretty busy, so
yeah.
I don't get to go out much. And, you know, once you get a kid. Well, you're lucky because you got the night job anyway,
right,
so you go, but you never went out that much anyway.
Right,
you were always a good boy. But.
I don't know if it's a good boy, but yeah.
Well, you look great, man.
You too, yeah.
It's good to see you.
It's good to see you too,
I just want to say hello. I'll talk to you soon, man.
Yeah, thank you so
much. Yeah.
Take care.
Yeah, all right. Talk to you soon. It's good to run into an old friend like that. That was David, who's actually the only I used to manage a band called the Sushi Cabaret Club, very talented band, and we had a bit of a falling out. The truth is, I did such a good job that they got hired, they got picked up by a bigger label, a proper label. We weren't a label then, but wake up, honey. One of the what the hell's the word? God, it's stipulations of the new contract was get rid of Victor. So they did. I don't blame them. But the way they did it was kind of backhanded, sneaky. So there's not much I could do about that. There's just two police officers there. They just passed me, so that was lucky. That's why they dropped the camera just now, because there was two police officers just now. Sorry about that. Anyway, what was I talking about? Yeah, Sushi Cabaret Club. They were a really good band. We were the biggest band in Nagoya, and I was the manager. I was top dog, and then they fired me. And that's when, but it was a mixed blessing, because thanks to that, I suddenly had all this fucking time And then that's when I started YouTubing. Here's another, that's another lesson of life that I learned, which I'll give you real quickly. So they treated me badly. They did me bad. And as a result, I was able to actually improve my life because I found all this time to do YouTube, and I got much more out of YouTube than I ever got out of managing the band. So you might think, well, they did me a favor. Yeah, but that doesn't mean that you can just forgive people for fucking you over. So that's something I learned a long time ago. That, yeah, that's it. It's basically pretty basic. You know, you might want to think, well, you did me a favor, so I forgive you. But no, people got to be asked to be forgiven. And to be fair, to be honest, they actually, the guy who ran the lead singer, he actually works or lives in the same neighborhood that I work in. So I would see him on occasion. We would ignore each other. I would ignore him mostly, but he once stopped me and said, look, I gotta apologize. And he apologized. He properly apologized. And it's, that's all he had to do. And I forgave him. This is a restaurant I've always wanted to come to. It looks so cool. I never come here. I always have weddings and shit here. Look at that. It's got a guy's steering wheel. Look at that. It's a beautiful restaurant. What was I talking about? Yes. So my son is great. He's learning so much. I had a whole blog about him, but I don't want to talk about that now. The temporariness of life is something that's been interesting to me recently, and it's making me think a lot. And something that you see echoes in everything. When you're thinking about something, you see it reflected in everything. And I was watching, this is going to sound ridiculous, but I was watching The Walking Dead, right? And in the, you know, if you've seen the first episode of the new season, I think it's season 7, episode 1, where they kill, spoilers coming, if you haven't seen it yet, then turn off this video for the next 15 seconds, okay? They kill Glenn and Abe, not in that order. But one of the things that Negan says to the group, to Rick, is, did you think you're gonna live? What was it? I forgot now. Did you think you're going to live happily ever after? That kind of thing, you know, and live on the same block and, you know, just live your lives out in peace. Did you really think that was going to happen? Well, it wasn't. He tells him that. And you see a scene of everybody, even the people who had been killed, towards the end of the show, the end of the episode. And everyone's just happily sitting at a big long table, eating dinner, sharing food. And it's just, it's a really nice, beautiful scene. But of course, it's a scene that's never going to happen. And these two people were snuffed out and their lives are gone. And that's happened to me. I know people whose lives are now gone. So I think about that, of course. Woo. Think about that. And I think about it a lot recently because I went to San Francisco last month on YouTube's dime. Thank you, YouTube. And I met my old best friend's wife, widow, I should say. Widow, yes, because he's dead now. And his son. You'd think it's a sad story, right? He died when she was pregnant. Well, he fell into a coma when she was pregnant, and then she died 2 years later, I think, in a coma. He died 2 years later in a coma. And we had a falling out about the same time. This is about the same time that I got fired from the Sushi Cabaret Club, so I kind of lost a lot of connections about the same time. The Sushi Cabaret Club is pretty much my biggest, the way, you know, I spent most of my time with them. Looking back, I can see now that we weren't really friends, though. At the time, I thought they were my best friends, but they fired me so easily that I guess that cured me of that illusion. I got pretty screwed over. But, you know, I'm not lingering on that. I'm not trying to So it happened. It's done, right? Look how empty the streets are. But at about the same time, my friend Jeff got a liver transplant, or was it kidney transplant, and fell in, and there was a complication. They put him into a chemically induced coma, and he never woke up. And about the same time, his wife had gotten pregnant. And we had had a falling out, so I happened to be in Tokyo again because YouTube had just paid for something for me to come up and visit and go to a big show. And he was in Tokyo in the hospital there, and I called a mutual friend. I said, "Can I come visit?" And they talked to the wife, and they said no, because of the falling out. Of course, she was upset. I don't blame her at all. But because of the falling out, she thought, you know, at that time, there was still hope that he would recover or wake up, come out of his coma. But because of that, she said, no, I don't want him to visit. And then 2 years later, he died. And I never did get a chance to visit him. And even when he died, I didn't see him at the funeral because my parents were visiting. And it just seemed awkward. I didn't want to, you know, I mean, this is a guy who had a falling out with a guy. It's a long story, but there's a video here on YouTube called, on my channel, I think it's Give Me a Flick Man, called Truth, which I talk about what happened in detail if you're interested. But here's the point, okay? He had a son. I guess it's 6 years ago now, because the kid's 6 years old, and he never got to meet him. So I always thought it's such a tragic, sad story. So when I went to San Francisco, they don't live in San Francisco. They live an hour and a half north of it. But I rented a car with the sole purpose of visiting her. Of course, I got her permission first on Facebook. I Facebooked her and said, "Can I come see you and your son?" And she said yes. And when I went up there, I expected some kind of, I don't know, something depressing or something, right? Because I'm visiting my ex-best friend's widow and her and his son that he never met. But it wasn't like that at all. She was so friendly and happy to see me. And she talked about Jeff as if he was just somewhere else visiting, you know? I mean, you know, of course, it wasn't like she was delusional or anything. No, she knew he was dead, but she knows he's dead. But she talked about him like, well, he's up there watching us, watching over us. And, you know, I don't believe in any of that stuff, but I knew him so well that even now it just seems amazing to me, incredible, unbelievable to me that he is dead. It just seems crazy that he is not here. I mean, he was, for all practical purposes, just an amazing human being, a superior human being in many, many ways, very intelligent, physically amazingly fit, taller, stronger. He was a great guy. Very smart guy. Anyway, but he died, because that's the way fucking life is. But anyway, the point is I saw her, and she was happy. I mean, not to say that she was happy because he was dead, of course, not that. But she had made her life, and she was doing okay. And her son was cool. He was a happy kid, you know. I gave him some presents. I brought up at the last moment, because I didn't know I was going to see him till the last moment. So I gave him some gifts. And he was a very honest kid. You know, kids are really honest, right? He like said, "Oh, I like this. Thank you." And "I don't like that. I don't need this. And take this away. You can keep this," right? It was pretty funny. But the point is that death didn't do anything. I mean, death, fuck death, you know. I mean, of course, death is horrible and sad, but they're alive and they're happy and life is beautiful. And then I came across, I teach English, and I tell my students to get Netflix, and I recommend shows for them because Netflix has bilingual options. And one of the new shows this month is something called Glitch. It's an Australian show and only has 6 episodes, but it's got a pretty weird premise. There's a cemetery and these 6 people rise from the cemetery, but they're not zombies or anything, right? They all rise from the dead, and they don't know, they don't remember their names at first. And they all come from different centuries. Somebody died 2 years ago, somebody died 30 years ago, someone died about 60 years ago, and someone died like 100 years ago. There's five of them. And someone died when Australia was formed. But anyway, the point is, there's one of the police officers discovers this and decides that this is an abomination. Yeah, abomination. It's an abomination, and that they must be killed. They must be returned to the grave. Because life, he says, without death has no meaning. And I thought about that, and I thought it was a very interesting sentence. I'm sure the writers did too, but yeah, life without death has no meaning. Think about that. And I thought about it, and my initial feeling was, yeah, if you don't die, you're just like a tree or a rock. Not even a tree, because a tree eventually dies, but like a rock. You're like an inanimate object, right? If you never die. I mean, it's like you're thinking, of course, but you're here forever. And that reminded me of something that struck me the other day on Facebook. I came across a photographer's Facebook page, and he said there's no point taking pictures of scenery and skies and nature, because they're all going to be here and they never really change. Only people do. So he takes only portraits. I also thought that was interesting. There's a cat. I saw a dead cat today. It's kind of sad. It was, well, of course it's sad. So death still makes me sad. Well, what am I saying? Death is sad. But life is amazing. So even though death is sad and death hurts us, life in the end is really, it just can't be beat. You can't beat life, man. Life is great. And yeah, I really want to put out this video of all these scenes of nature that I saw. Not just the sky and shit, you know, it's just nothing even special. Just, I use a couple filters, but anyway, just nature. And recently, as much as I agree with that statement, whoops, I'm running the red light. Woo. I agree with the statement that, you know, there's not much point in taking pictures of nature and the skyline, because it's always going to be there. And humans are a much more challenging subject. That it still touches me. It still makes me feel like life is just amazing. And I feel like it's a reflection of something that is just, how do I explain it? Without invoking God, because I don't believe in God. But I feel like there's just something just beautiful out there and bigger than all of us. So I'm sure if those of you who do believe in God will use that as the explanation, but I don't need that explanation. And I don't even need an explanation at all. All I want to say is, I think it's all temporary. I don't believe in heaven. I don't believe in hell. And when I'm dead, I'm going to be gone forever. But damn, it's really exciting to be here. I'm really happy to be here. And I'm really having a good time. Even when it's difficult. Even when I spend a lot of time working, because I do. You know, supporting the family and all that. And a lot of it's self-imposed. I'm spending time in ways that are not efficient. I gotta fix that. I gotta take care of that. But despite that, despite the difficulties I have in life, it's still a beautiful life. And I'm happy to be here. And I'm happy to know everyone, to meet everyone. And I am a happy guy, and I am angry a lot, but I'm also happy a lot. And I'm just in awe a lot of the time. I should really start a religion based on this, except I don't, it'll be a religion based on what? I feel like more people need to understand that life is great and temporary, but death is not to be feared. and hallelujah. And now we enter the tunnel that I hate walking through because I always feel like I'm going to be crushed by a car. Anyway, thanks for watching, guys. Thanks for listening, as always. I hope I meet you all someday, one by one. If you see me, say hello. Talk to you soon.